1944, the greatest amphibious invasion in history lands on the Normandy beaches. Today, the wreckage of war still stands in the shallows where 35 years ago, armies drawn from much of the free world began the liberation of Europe. But great events are not new to these shores. For the whole of recorded history, momentous waves of immigrants and invaders have crossed the narrow sea between England and the continent and shaped our history. 900 years ago, an amphibious invasion left these shores which was to have as great an effect on our destiny as 1944 may prove to have. From these beaches, in 1066, an army set sail for England. Its leader would become known to history as William the Conqueror. The Norman Conquest is by far the most famous event in British history. Everybody has heard of 1066, the Battle of Hastings, and Harold with the arrow in his eye. And the marks of the conquest are still everywhere to be seen, especially in the great castles by which the Normans fastened their hold on England. Like this one, the White Tower of the Tower of London, constructed at the command of William the Conqueror himself on the site of the fortress he built here in 1066. The conquest is also the most controversial event in British history. It's been seen as the fall of England's liberty and the rise of her greatness. Without it, it's been argued the English would have been merely a dull and boorish race of Anglo-Saxons lumbering around, amiable, pot-bellied, and drunken. So what actually happened in 1066, and why? And what of the great man who was at the center of these events? The search for William the Conqueror begins not in his Kingdom of England, but in his dukedom, a tiny former Viking province over the sea in Normandy. Normans are as fiercely proud of their separateness as Yorkshiremen. And their origins are similar. They too were Vikings. And as in Northern England, their names still bear testimony to the Scandinavian stock of their ancestors. It was in 911 that the French king allowed a Viking army to settle in this northwestern part of his kingdom, a deal similar to that made by Alfred the Great with the Vikings in England. In return for land, the Northmen became liegemen to the French. But their paths soon diverged, and by 1066, Normandy had long been a political entity separate from the Kingdom of France. This is Falaise, scene of some of the fiercest fighting in 1944. William was born here in 1027, the bastard son of Duke Robert. The 12th century castle stands on the site of the earlier fort William knew from boyhood. His ancestors had been nominally Christian, but theirs was a semi-pagan world, living behind their castle walls, hunting, feasting and fighting, illiterate and uncultured. In these parts, they even spoke Viking as late as the 11th century, although William was brought up here speaking Norman French. As in most countries in the Dark Ages, it was the church which brought civilization to such warlords in return for their goodwill and patronage. And William's father was noted for his religious bent. So his son was born into the mainstream of European Catholicism. But if William's father came from one of the most important families in Europe, his mother was a different matter. Tradition has it that she was a poor tanner's daughter from here in Falaise. And so the story goes that one day Duke Robert was looking out of his castle window up there above us, and he saw the beautiful Erlève washing her clothes down by the river here. Elle avait couleur plus fine que fleur de rose, said the later romancers. It's a good story, and there may be something in it, because the medieval washhouses, which we're now in, are still here by the river in Falaise, and the tanneries here were also famous. William's father never married his mother, but at the age of 7 or 8, William became Duke when his father died on a pilgrimage to Jerusalem. The next few years of his life were terrible ones because the ducal palace was split by rival factions, a place of murder and intrigue. William's own guardian was killed, and his mother's brother used to sleep armed with his young nephew and sometimes whisk him away in the middle of the night to a neighboring poor man's cottage to escape the assassins whose daggers and poison were the arbiters of Norman politics at that time. With that kind of schooling, it's not surprising that the young William grew up a hard man who covered up his feelings. The teenage Duke was tall, powerful, ruthless, thoughtful, implacable in will, and above all, skilled in war. Normandy was a society geared to war, and its essential instrument was the mounted knight. By the 1050s, the Normans had developed a kind of new model army, mounted on trained and bred horses, heavily equipped and armored, accustomed to operating in squadrons and to respond to flag signaling, experts in breaking up and routing a defeated army. In the 1050s, alarmed by the rising military power of his erstwhile subordinate, the French King Henry I decided to crush the young Duke William. Their decisive meeting took place at Varaville, near Caen, near fields now marked by Allied war cemeteries of 1944. In the face of William's Norman knights, King Henry attempted to transfer his army across the River Dives and engage him. But William cut off his advance guard and annihilated it here, while Henry watched, powerless, from a neighboring hill. Even when they tried to surrender, the French were butchered or drowned in the turbid waters of the Dives. The 30-year-old Duke had learned early to use terror as a means of enforcing his will. The Normans are great conquerors, men said. At fighting, there is none like them. Normanorum comitem Wilhelmum, cum adversus Anglorum gentem mari transiturus pareretur ad bellum. William, Duke of the Normans, as he prepared to cross over the sea to wage war against the English people, makes this grant to the monastery of St. Martin freely and with all his will. Single-mindedly devoted to the church, the illiterate William founded a string of great abbeys whose talented personnel were to become the most progressive and intellectually forceful in the West. This is one, Jumièges, prototype of the great abbeys built in England after 1066. When William invaded England, the full spiritual backing of the Western Church would be behind him. Much of William's wealth derived from tolls on river traffic at his great port of Rouen. As throughout French history, the Seine was the great artery of civilization and trade. The old commercial center of Rouen grew up within the Roman walls east of the cathedral. Here, the medieval streets are still preserved despite the devastating bombing of 1944. William built a stone palace here,
and in the years before 1066, his charters show he often held court here, collecting his revenues and compelling the attendance of his magnates. Both the wealth of the church and William's own position depended on the cooperation of the secular aristocracy, and especially a handful of powerful families whose names were to be famous in English history: Warenne, Beaumont, Fitzosborne. With their estates in the lush valleys of the Pays d'Auge, these families owned land on condition that they provided William with the heavily armed nucleus of his army, a form of obligation we know now as feudalism. This is the Valley of the Touques, and we've come here to find the ancestral home of one such family, the Montgomerys, ancestors of the English Field Marshal who returned in 1944. There is much debate over the form of Norman fortification before 1066. As yet, no systematic excavation has been undertaken at any of their pre-conquest sites. Even finding them can be difficult. At Saint-Germain de Montgomery, I was passed by the local chemist to the Calvados maker to a wood owned by the Camembert fabricateur.
I don't think this is actually the original entrance to the castle. That is obviously the original encircling ditch. It's still really massive, but this looks like a 19th century farm cart track. These are the original encircling banks surrounding it, and through here should be Roger of Montgomery's living space. And here it is, a perfect 11th century defended farmstead. It doesn't look much. There probably just would have been a timber palisade round here. The farmer tells me he's never discovered any remains of stonework, and just a few buildings inside, maybe a hall, a chapel, a bower, or something like that. It is simply a great ringwork with a ditch round it. That suggests that this was probably the pre-conquest castle of the Montgomerys. It's earlier than 1066, in other words. A small place, but from this little place, great things grew.
Caen, citadel of William the Conqueror. This gigantic circuit, shattered by Allied shelling in 1944, was fortified in wood and stone by William around 1060. 1,000 yards of defences with rock-cut ditches protected the ducal hall whose stone footings have now been located. Until recently, it was thought that the town below was a new creation by the Norman dukes of the 11th century. Now we know there was a complex of 6 churches as early as the 8th century. The excavations at Caen have been supervised by Michel de Bois, doyen of Norman studies. Resistance hero, concentration camp survivor, de Bois understands the hard realities of power which made the conqueror the political genius of his time.
On s'aperçoit que c'était un homme qui était capable.
One perceives that this was a man who had qualities of heart. For example, he loved his mother very much. She was a woman of modest origin, bourgeois stock, but he exhibited a very deep attachment to her.
Très profond. Je pense que voir en lui simplement une brute, ce serait injuste.
I think that to see in him simply a beast would be unjust. He was a man who was profoundly engaged in his enterprises. Moreover, he involved himself personally, especially on the field of battle.
Dès son adolescence, les premiers combats qu'il a livrés.
From his adolescence, in the first battles he fought in the west of France, in Poitou.
Les écrivains du temps admirent beaucoup et
the writers of the time tremendously admired and singled out this figure whom they saw always in the most dangerous places.
Il s'engageait profondément dans toutes ses entreprises.
So he was deeply engaged in all his undertakings, and that perhaps explains his severity. But the quality we must also acknowledge in him is reflection. He never committed an unreasoned or impulsive act.
Je ne sais pas si vous vous rappelez le livre magnifique de Sir Frank Beristain.
I don't know whether you remember the magnificent book of Sir Frank Stenton, Anglo-Saxon England, which is in some an Anglo-Saxonist's apology. Perhaps I shouldn't say it's anti-Norman. The conclusion of this book is notable because Stenton wrote it with his intellect, with his spirit, and with his heart. And he said that these Normans who conquered England, they didn't do this, they didn't do that. In matters of art, of literature, and institutions, they hadn't what we had.
But politically, they were the masters of their world. Voilà, voilà la raison.
Oui. Les Anglais considèrent que la conquête était la perte de leur...
So does Professor de Bouard agree with the English view of the Norman conquest as the great loss of our liberty?
Ah oui, je crois, oui.
Oui.
Oui, je le crois. Oui, oui.
If I were English, I'd be an Anglo-Saxonist. I believe I wouldn't like the Normans.
Je ne serais pas normandiste.
Anglo-Saxon England. Delectable, fertile, and rich, as continental travelers said. William may have sailed here as early as 1051 to visit his kinsman, the English king, Edward the Confessor. We are now sailing into Bosham in Sussex. We have come here to meet the other great protagonist of William's story. Bosham was a manor of Harold Godwinson, Earl of Wessex, the most powerful man in England. It can still show the Anglo-Saxon church which Harold knew and where he prayed. Here in the spring of 1064, Harold held a dinner with friends in the upstairs room of his manor house on this site. Their conversation was on a matter of great import. He knew that the old King Edward was childless. Harold himself had already been implicated in the murder of two of Edward's kinsmen. He also knew that Edward's mother, Emma, wife of Ethelred the Unready, had been Norman, and that Edward's closest kinsman on his mother's side was William himself. There was even talk that Edward had promised William the throne. The throne which Harold wanted. The next day, Harold set sail from Bosham for Normandy. His aim, perhaps, was to strike some sort of bargain with William. But a storm blew up and he was shipwrecked on the French coast. He was escorted to Rouen, and there he came face to face with the Norman Duke. He was to spend some time in Normandy, fighting at William's side in warfare by Mont Saint-Michel, where he impressed the Normans with his bravery and strength. Duke William even decorated Harold with the marks of Norman chivalry. But there was a catch. William, too, was covetous of the English throne, and here at Bayeux, he revealed that he would not let Harold return without taking an oath to support him. We can follow these events in great detail on an extraordinary embroidery preserved here in Bayeux. It's time for us to look at this work more closely. The Bayeux Tapestry.
And here it is. This is undoubtedly the most fantastic source for early medieval history as a whole in Europe. This is the Bayeux Tapestry, preserved in Bayeux, a 230-foot linen record of the Norman conquest. It's not, in fact, a tapestry. It's an embroidery done in coloured woolen threads. And it tells the story of the Norman conquest from that first fateful journey from Bosham to Harold's death on the field of Hastings. And Harold is the real tragic hero of the story. Although William of Normandy presides over the story like a stern judge, Harold is the tragic hero, the noble man who makes the wrong decision. And the tapestry artist sees the wrong decision as this moment in Bayeux when Harold swore to Duke William that he would be his vicarius, as another Norman source says. He would be his second in command. He would help him gain the English throne. So from the moment of that oath-taking, which contemporaries would see as the most dire undertaking, from that moment, everybody knew that Duke William would contest the English throne the moment King Edward died.
Events now gathered an inexorable momentum. On January the 5th, 1066, Edward died and was buried in his new church at Westminster. Just before he died, he seems to have asked Harold to be the protector of his kingdom and his family. Then, immediately, those English nobles who were assembled in London offered Harold the crown. We have no idea whether this was a popular move or a coup engineered by a clique. But the very next day, Harold was crowned King of the English in Westminster Abbey.
The ceremony took place on the 6th of January, the day after Edward's death, before the funeral meats were cold. Unseemly haste, perhaps, in anybody's book, but there were political reasons why Harold had to hurry, and the English councillors too, because they clearly were going to need a strong man in office. And the constitutional proprieties seemed to have been observed. Harold had probably been designated, the councillors in London had offered him the crown, and he was orthodoxly consecrated in Westminster Abbey. And this scene in the Bayeux tapestry represents Harold in glory being shown to the people after the consecration. Not the consecration itself. So Harold had been legitimately crowned in English eyes, but to the Normans he was a usurper, and a little touch by the tapestry artist shows us again their point of view. Here, by Harold, perhaps acclaiming him to the people, is Archbishop Stigand of Canterbury. Now, Stigand had been disowned by the papacy in Rome, and in fact, we know from English sources that because of that, Harold had himself crowned by Archbishop Aldred of York, whose authority was unimpeachable. But here, the tapestry is trying to impugn Harold's legitimacy by connecting him with Stigand. What must Harold have felt like that day, with the Christmas decorations perhaps still up in Westminster, and the weight of the crown on his head, and surely the weight of the oath of Bayeux on his mind? One thing must have been very clear to him. By having himself crowned, the die was cast, and he would have to fight.
William was out hunting when he received the news. Speechless, he threw a cloak over his face in a black fury. He assembled his magnates here in the valley of the Touques, near the sea at Bonneville. This was a favored residence of William. His charters show he frequently stayed here, probably in a timber hall behind its palisaded banks. This hall was later rebuilt in stone, and its foundations have been found in the grounds of the 19th century house of the present owner. Here, a great meeting of Norman nobles was held that spring. And when they heard William's intention was to invade Europe's richest country to recover what he felt to be his rightful claim, they were dismayed and noisily vented their feelings to him. But William won the day, fluent and persuasive, men said, adept at bending men to his will. He ordered a fleet to be constructed. And so, hammers and axes resounded in the forests of the Touques, the Dives, and the Orne. Trees were felled, planks planed, and ships built. Arms and provisions were taken to the ships, suits of mail, helmets, swords, racks of lances, stocks of spare arrows, provisions, war gear, and spares to supply an army which Michel de Bois estimates at 15,000 men, including at least 3,000 mounted knights. By August the 12th, the fleet was moored in the mouth of the River Dives. But at this climactic moment, the weather turned against William. And like that later D-Day, he was forced to wait for a fair wind while his strength and morale diminished. Meanwhile, an event of terror and ill omen afflicted Harold. Halley's Comet, which visits our sun every 77 years, was seen throughout England. In the tapestry below the king, spectral ships invade his troubled mind. But as Harold anxiously waited for William, an unexpected and terrible blow struck him at the other end of his kingdom. Far to the north, in Norway, one of Europe's most famous warriors had been chafing at the bit. King Harald Hardrada, the Ruthless, had an army and a full treasury, and nowhere to expend them. He also had a claim to England through a pact made by his kinsman with King Canute, and in mid-September, the wind which had pinned William down wafted Hardrada to Britain in the company of King Harald's renegade brother Tosti, the exiled Earl of Northumbria. Together they sacked Scarborough, sailed into the Humber, and landed their fleet at Rickall in the River Ouse. Then, in a bloody battle, they defeated the Northumbrian army at Fulford outside York. Suddenly, all Harold's plans were cast to the wind. After their victory, the Norwegians retired to a road junction east of York to await supplies and hostages. The place was called Stamford Bridge. King Harold must have been dumbfounded by the news from Yorkshire. What should he do now?
He decided to march north, straight up the Great North Road, riding day and night, as the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle says, gathering his levies as fast as he could. It was a very brave decision. He was trying to deliver a knockout blow against the Norwegians in Yorkshire, and then to get back down south before Duke William could land.
Harold had set out around September the 20th. On the Sunday night, 24th of September, he reached Tadcaster, where he prepared his army for battle, and in particular his housecarls, the professional corps of his army. The next morning he rode straight on through York, which only the day before had surrendered to Hardrada. There was no resistance. Desperate to prevent any news of his advance leaking to the invaders, he immediately pressed on, driving his troops forward.
The last stage of the attack, as the day gradually grew brighter, was a 7-mile advance up the Roman road from York onto Stamford Bridge, where, in the valley of the Derwent, the Norwegian army lay completely unsuspecting.
The first inkling the Norsemen had of his approach was a cloud of dust on the road, and then the flash of weapons, like the sun glancing off a field of ice, the Norwegians said later. Stamford Bridge then was simply a road crossing in a shallow river valley with low ridges on either side. The Norwegians had left their armor and part of their forces with their ships, and they first tried to delay the English crossing by holding the bridge on the York side. The old bridge lay here, 400 yards upstream from today's crossing, and here the first fighting took place. Eventually, only one Norwegian was left on the English bank, and he resisted heroically for some time before he was cut down. The English now crossed, and the main battle began. It was fought here, east of the bridge, and culminated in this field, still called Battle Flat. Here, King Harald's housecarls eventually wiped out the Norwegian army in a dreadful bloodbath. All their leaders fell, Hardrada himself and Tosti. Only 24 shiploads of survivors returned from 300. Their bones remained a landmark for decades until they were collected and buried here. With this catastrophic defeat, the Viking Age symbolically comes to an end. But an age even more momentous was about to be born. 2 days later, the wind changed, and Duke William put to sea. At dawn on September the 28th, 1066, the Normans touched land at Pevensey in Sussex. When he jumped ashore, Duke William fell. But deftly turning the bad omen to good, he rose with his fists full of pebbles, saying, "Look, I have taken hold of England." The English army was nowhere to be seen. At that moment, William cannot have known that Harold was tending his wounded 250 miles to the north. The luck of war had fallen with the Normans. William's first night on English soil was spent within these fortifications of the Roman fort at Pevensey, now a mile from the sea. We don't know whether he slept well, though knowing him, he probably did. And while he slept, post riders sped the news to Harold. The net was closing on Anglo-Saxon England. 4 days later, Harold began the weary march back south. His forces were now badly depleted, and he had to rely on his own standing army and on mercenaries. But ordinary Englishmen did join him on his march. Among them, Edrich, a freeman from Cavendish in Suffolk, Thurkill from Kingston in Berkshire, Ednoth, a small holder from Sudbury in Hampshire. These men fought and died for Harold, or for England, in 1066. The rendezvous Harold appointed was Coldbeck Hill, near the modern village of Battle in Sussex. Then locals knew it simply as the Grey Apple Tree. Harold hoped to surprise William as he had Hardrada, but the Norman Duke knew his man. His scouts had told him of Harold's approach, and he was ready. Having ridden through the night, Harold was still in line of march as day approached on the 14th of October. William immediately gave the order to advance from his camp at Hastings on the coast. Harold's plan had gone disastrously wrong, and as dawn rose, he had no choice but to hastily improvise a defensive array against the expected Norman attack.
William probably reached this spot about 7 in the morning, and so for the first time he could see for himself what kind of battle he would have to fight. The English army was jammed on that ridge where the abbey now stands, on a front of only about a few hundred yards, a few thousand men at the most. And William could quite clearly see that they were in a terrible state, very disorganized, with no proper battle array. He could also see that Harold himself was there, because where that ruin stands, on the right-hand side of the abbey, were the two standards, the Dragon of Wessex and Harold's own standard, the Fighting Man. William immediately gave the order to attack, and soon after 8 o'clock, the battle began, with the Norman archers making their way slowly up the hillside towards the English. They only had short bows with a range of about 100 yards, so they literally had to see the whites of the English eyes before they could fire. And their attack had very little effect. Their arrows either took on the shields of the housecarls or went over their heads. And so the second phase began, with the Norman heavy infantry moving forwards to try and break up the English line. And on this sector here, the Breton forces on the left wing of the Norman army immediately ran into trouble. When they got up the hill within range of the English line, they met a ferocious reception of, first of all, missiles, stones, sticks, spears, anything at hand. And then they met the dreaded axes of the housecarls themselves. And they soon broke in panic and fled back down into the valley, taking with them all the cavalry units lined up behind them. And so, within a very short time of the battle beginning, the whole of William's left wing was incapacitated and struggling in this marshy valley bottom here in front of us. And at this point, part of the English army, thinking that the battle was won, left the ridge and chased after them.
A lesser man could have lost everything in this moment. But William had been a leader of men since his teens, and always in the most dangerous part of the battle. And he now tore off his helmet and rode through his men shouting, "Look at me, I am alive, and by God's will I will conquer yet." He then led his cavalry reserve from the center and cut off the pursuers on the left of the field where there was a pronounced hillock.
The hillock portrayed in the Bayeux tapestry is still here today, and it was the site of a great disaster for King Harold, because a large number of the English levies who had been cut off by William's outflanking movement were trapped here and annihilated in full view of all their comrades on the hill. And that disaster must have seriously weakened the right wing of King Harold's army. And with that, Duke William then decided, although the English main ranks were still unbroken, to launch a massive cavalry attack against them. And we can imagine 2,000 or even 3,000 heavily mailed Norman knights kicking their horses up this hill towards Harold's position.
Gritting their teeth, the Norman knights spurred their frightened marts into a tremendous storm of missiles. But deprived of their impetus and forced to jab or throw their lances, they received a savage beating at the hands of the English frontline troops, some of whose axes the Normans saw incredulously cut down horse and rider in one blow. Once again, however, when the Normans fell back, part of Harold's army ran after them, and once more William was able to wipe them out. But still there was nothing in it. They made no impression on us all day, the English alleged later. This was a new kind of warfare for us, said the Normans, our side constantly on the attack, and theirs rooted to the ground. William was now able to use his cavalry and archers together, shooting arrows over his horsemen onto the English heads. This final torment was decisive. The tapestry now shows men clutching shafts in eyes or face, and at this point, Harold himself was struck by an arrow in the eye. This famous legend is not accepted today, but a detailed study of the tapestry artist's technique suggests that he clearly intended this scene to show King Harold both wounded and later cut down. And so, with their king badly hurt, his army were dismayed and braced themselves to face the end.
By about 5 o'clock, with the October dusk coming on, it must have seemed quite clear that the English position was hopeless. Their army had contracted to a nucleus on the very top of the hill itself, around the royal standards, where we're now standing. It was comprised mainly of the housecarls and the king's own personal retinue, and they fought on doggedly, so densely packed, according to the Normans, that the dead could not fall. But eventually, their defense too was broken, and four knights in particular broke through, seized the royal standards, and quite literally hacked King Harold to death in the place where William later built the high altar of his abbey here at Battle.
Da Franciscan, oton whilst away go yield. El swahim God uthe for folkes sinnen. The French won, as God granted them, for our nation's sins. Harold's remains were buried by the seashore he had fought so bravely to defend. Later, they were removed to his own foundation at Waltham Abbey, where the site of the tomb is shown today. Not surprisingly, legends grew up of his survival, stories to comfort the defeated English in later years. It is rare that one battle proves so decisive. With no royal kinsman of mature age, the English councillors offered William the crown, and on Christmas Day 1066, less than a year after the confessor's death, he was crowned in Westminster Abbey. The ceremony, which was the culmination of William's career, did not go without hitch. When the crowd in the church gave their shout of acclamation, the Norman soldiers outside, fearing a riot, fired neighboring buildings. With the smoke and confusion outside, the lurid glow of the flames, and shouts in a language he did not understand, William gripped the throne with white knuckles and trembled. The first time, said one who knew him, that he'd seen William show emotion. But if the English church establishment thought that William might be another Canute, content to rule in the old way, they were in for a shock. In the next 5 years, William consolidated his hold on England by building motte and bailey castles of earth and wood in virtually every town and sizable village. They were particularly numerous on the Welsh border. Here, William set up great lordships, giving vast tracts of land to subordinates who'd served him well. One was our old acquaintance, Roger of Montgomery, who gave his name to the county town of Montgomeryshire, a planned town of the 12th century with its later medieval castle on a crag dominating the border landscape. But Roger's first castle, built in the years immediately after the conquest, is very different in character. It lies covered by trees a mile away and is now being excavated by Phil Barker.
So far as we know, no other motte and bailey castle in Britain and probably in Europe is being excavated in such detail. And we've recovered evidence for over 50 buildings in just one half of the bailey.
50?
50, I think.
The school book image of Norman castles is not of 50 buildings in a space like this.
In fact, it's absolutely jam-packed with buildings.
What kind of buildings did you find?
Well, they're very massive indeed. Their defences are very massive. There are residential buildings, of course, granaries, and we think we've got a chapel. We've certainly got a hall with a hearth. Many of them were two stories. They were built with very massive timbers. A lot of them had thick clay walls, which we can prove. But most of all, you wouldn't be able to stand where we are and see the view because the defences were two-tiered. You had a fighting platform which had rooms underneath it and therefore must have been 6 or 7 feet high above the ground. Then you had a palisade above that. And so the palisade on top of its rampart was at least 14 feet high. So you'd get a sense of oppression in here. The other point that's worth making is that there wouldn't be a tree within a couple of miles. They wouldn't leave a tree or a bush for a Welshman to hide behind. So this beautiful sylvan landscape just wouldn't be allowed to happen. It would be totally cleared. Mm. This would be a thorn in the side of the Welsh. It would be a raw castle of bare earth and bare timber in a completely blitzed landscape.
What about Roger de Montgomery himself? Would he actually have lived here or stayed here?
I don't think he lived here very much because he'd got a castle in Shrewsbury and another one in Arundel, apart from those in Normandy. But you must remember that this didn't have a name when he built it, so he gave it its name, which has stuck ever since.
It does sound a very kind of functional military way of life.
I think the first castle was on the front line. I think it was a very hard life. It was full of tough and ruthless men, like a bunch of SAS men, who lived just to fight and to conquer.
And so, in this manner, William oppressed the poor people by building castles everywhere, as a contemporary said. And as evening fell at Hendomen, sitting around the campfire in the shadow of Roger's motte, it seemed an appropriate place for the defeated English to talk about their new government.
I'm an Anglo-Saxonist, I suppose, and I like the Anglo-Saxons. And this strikes me as being something quite different.
I think it represents oppression, if that's what you mean. And I think that through the feudal system, whereby almost certainly on the Welsh border, which is the bit we know best, almost every landowner seems to have had a fortification. He's fortified his farmhouse, in effect. It represents a great pyramid of fortification, which is there either to hold down somebody else or to make quite certain that you hold what you've got. What we, of course, shall never know is what would have happened if the Norman Conquest hadn't happened. But it's true, isn't it? There was a lot of Norman influence in England before the Conquest. And I think it's on the cards that if the Norman Conquest hadn't happened, within 100 years or so, England would still have been just as much a part of the continent as she was with, you know, the invention of Gothic architecture, the sort of general Gothic civilization which developed up to 1200.
French friends like to think that it was only because of the Norman Conquest that we're even remotely civilized, but
What do you think? Well, I think this is a gross distortion, because if there was a highly civilized country in Europe in the early 11th century, it must have been the Anglo-Saxons. And although I'm sure the Normans, with their short haircuts and so on, thought them a bit effete, nevertheless, I mean, if you look at the Winchester School of Illumination or the great embroideries, the last of which was the Bayeux tapestry, all that goes. And although we haven't got great pieces of Anglo-Saxon architecture, or not many of them left, this is not where their skills lay. And I don't think that that's true at all. And I think that it was strong government imposed on this little country. And a lot of people think that was a very good thing indeed, but not everybody does.
The castles, in fact, were merely the outward sign of the real revolution. The 20 years after the conquest saw an unparalleled redistribution of wealth in England, as William's supporters in 1066 received their slice of the cake.
Even the most fervent Anglo-Saxonist must admire William's amazing ability to get what he wanted, being skilled at all times in making his will clear, as one said who knew him, and most typical of his grasping governmental expertise was his decision late in his life to have the whole of England surveyed for the purposes of taxation. And so comprehensively was this done, and so little recourse possible against it, that in a very short time the resulting document became known as Domesday Book. And this is it. We're in the Public Record Office in Chancery Lane in London, in a room which is a repository of 900 years of British history. But Domesday Book has pride of place as the first and greatest of the public records. It was in Gloucester in 1085, over Christmas, that William had deep speech with his councillors about what kind of land England was, how it was populated, and who owned the land. And then he sent his agents into all the shires to determine how much taxable land there was and what his own dues were. And the work was done so thoroughly, says the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, that scarcely a cow or an ox or a pig escaped. Shameful as that is to relate, adds the chronicler, he saw no shame in doing it, for greediness he loafed mid el. So much so, in fact, that he sent a second group of assessors after the first to check on their work. In comparison, the modern VAT man holds few terrors. Let's have a look at the entry for Montgomery. Like most of the book, it's written in a single English hand, surprisingly, not a Norman hand. Perhaps an old Anglo-Saxon civil servant who'd seen it all from the days of King Edward. Right, here we are, in the castle of Montgomery. The Earl has 4 ploughs and £6 in pennies as a levy from a district over the Welsh border. And the second reference to Montgomery here, the Earl himself built a castle called Montgomery, to which are attached 52 hides. That's the Anglo-Saxon unit of assessment. And in King Edward's day, these were held by the thanes Siward, Oslac, and Oswor, and they used the land for hunting. Now, we happen to know from a later lease book that Oswor's family still held some of their own family land a generation later, but they were the lucky ones. In general, the Domesday Book tells a story of a catastrophic revolution for the English ruling class. In this book, only 8% of England is still owned by Englishmen in 1086, and only 2 of the 1,400 chief tenants are English. Of the sorrow of those dispossessed Englishmen, of course, there is little mention in a work of bureaucracy, but there is one little touch. At Marsh Gibbon in Buckinghamshire, in 1066, this land was held by Aelric freely from King Edward. And now, in 1086, tenet ad firma de Wilhelmo gravita et miserabiliter. Aelric now holds it rented from William and Norman with a heavy heart and wretchedly. Domesday Book is not a portrait of Norman England, it's a portrait of Anglo-Saxon England, the England of Edward the Confessor. And as such, it marks not so much a beginning in English history as the culmination of 500 years of development, a portrait of the society built up by Offa, Alfred the Great, Athelstan, and Canute. A unified country with a vernacular literature, a standardized form of Old English, and sophisticated forms of government, chancery, coinage, and law. 1066 was the last occasion on which England was conquered by a foreign invader. And the Normans took over not a provincial backwater, but an older and in some respects a superior civilization. It was the Anglo-Saxon achievement to build England. It was left to the Normans and their successors to make Great Britain. And as yet, they have not succeeded half so well.
Motte, 40 miles from Paris, inside the French kingdom. In the summer of 1087, William totally destroyed this place, church and all, after the garrison had resisted him. Among the dead were hermits burned alive in the firestorm. Now 60 years old, corpulent and cantankerous, William could no more be crossed than in his youth. But as he rode through the burning streets, his horse threw him and fatally ruptured his stomach. In great pain, William retired to Rouen, to the priory of St. Gervais in the western suburbs. There, the man who was too relentless to care, though all might hate him, burst into floods of tears as he prayed for divine mercy. He also expressed penitence for the vast bloodshed which had been the price of his greatness. He died at dawn on the 9th of September, 1087, within earshot of the church bells. He was buried in his monastery at Caen, the Abbey aux Hommes. The tomb was destroyed in religious rioting in the 16th century, and today a simple stone slab marks the spot. There is a bizarre tailpiece to his career. His tomb was opened in 1522, and his embalmed body found to be remarkably preserved. A local painter in Caen was hired to make a likeness. This is the only surviving copy. The costume is that of a Renaissance prince, but is the face that of the conqueror? If anyone wants to know what kind of man he was, then I shall write of him as I knew him and lived in his court. King William was a man of great wisdom and power, unsurpassed in honor and strength. But he was stern beyond measure to those who opposed his will. A hard man, sunk in greed, and utterly given up to avarice. May Almighty God have mercy on his soul and pardon him his sins.